Hi, and welcome to Digital Integrated Circuits. This is Lecture 1, Introduction. I'm Dr. Adam Teman of the Emerging Nanoscaled Integrated Circuits and Systems Labs in the Faculty of Engineering at Bar-Ilan University. So, in this lecture, we're going to start with an intro to the intro, then go into the world of chip design, and finally have a small section called How a Chip is Born. So, let's start with the intro to the intro. Okay, so what are we going to do in this course? I'm not sure if you've seen online, but I have a previous course called Digital Integrated Circuits. That's the intro to what a digital circuit is and how to make a basic digital gate. In this course, we're going to step up a level. We're going to learn about designing actual digital gates. These types of gates are going to be used in full digital abstracted implementation flow. We're going to deepen our understanding about the trade-offs in VLSI design. We're going to learn how to design bigger and more complex components, such as arithmetic circuits and memories. We're going to learn about parasitics that are inherent to integrated circuit design. We're going to learn about technology scaling, how this affects us at the process modeling and design levels, and study basic methods to deal with the resulting effects. We're going to be learning about designing in the nanoscale era, i.e. today. And we're going to start to learn about how to put it all together towards a compiling a VLSI chip. So this is kind of an advanced course on digital circuits. We're going to see how to take digital circuits and do real things with them without lying about too many things that are hidden under the hood. Okay, but we have to remember, and this is true to almost anything in engineering, there is basically no free lunch. As you see, whatever mouse comes over here and tries to eat this cheese, he's not going to have a free lunch. This is the basic motto of the course and in engineering in general. We always have to know that we have trade-offs. Whatever we do, whatever we try to make better, there's a good chance that we're going to make something else worse. And when we're discussing VLSI in general, many things in engineering actually, the four main categories that we usually discuss are over here: performance, cost, reliability, and power. Performance is another name usually for speed. Okay? And that's what usually, or at least in the past, used to sell chips. We want to sell our CPU with a higher frequency because it looks good, but it also does more stuff. Okay, so performance, we usually say speed or frequency. We also may be saying throughput. That may not be the same thing. These are things that we may discuss during this course, but more in other courses. Okay, so performance is usually the thing, is generally used to be the thing that we would always try to head for. Now, sometimes we will go to other things such as power. Cost is synonymous in a lot of ways in this field with area. So silicon real estate is the most expensive real estate in the world. Making these chips, as we'll see, is really, really, really expensive. And so the actual area of each a component in the chip, it costs a lot of money. And that's why we want to make our gates smaller, we want to make our circuits smaller, we want to make our components smaller, and so forth. The smaller the area, the less our chip will cost. That's in a small nutshell, and we're going to learn different models of how to define cost and so forth in this course, but cost is a big part of anything to do with integrated circuit design. Power has become possibly the most important factor that we're going to go for nowadays. We can also call this energy. And that's basically for all of us who are using different mobile devices nowadays, such as cell phones. We want our battery to last as long as possible. The more power that our circuit's going to dissipate, the less time our battery's going to work. But if we go on to the other side, such as in a data center, the more power that our computers are going to use, the more heat they're going to create, and that heat has to be taken away, and that costs money. Those are two little points of power that are main, maybe, things about power, but there are a lot of other aspects of power. And as you see, these things also affect cost. They also can, for instance, slow down the speed, so hurt performance and so forth. And the final one that we haven't discussed that much in previous courses is reliability. And reliability has two great aspects. One is called yield. It means how many chips we make and how many of them actually work, how many of them we have to throw away and waste. So that's one aspect of reliability. And the other one we may discuss is something we usually call aging. How long will these chips work for? If we sell a chip now, when will it finally break down at the customer? And those are two problems that we have to discuss. Okay, so reliability is another factor that's very important. All of these, they really affect each other. They trade off with each other. If we can improve more than one of these at a time, we would usually call this a win-win situation, and that's what we'll try to do. But usually if we, for example, try to raise the performance, we're going to raise the power as well, and that's not very good. Or if we want a better performing circuit, it's probably going to cost more. So we're going to always try to find ways that we can improve at least more than one of these factors. So a little bit about the course syllabus. The course has three main parts. The first part is called How Transistors Actually Come to This World. The second part is called Honey, I Shrunk the Transistors. And the third part is called Let's Go Out and Play. Okay, so we're starting the first part today, and we start with this short introduction. Then we go over in the next lecture to a lot about the CMOS manufacturing process, how we actually build these chips. Okay, so once we've built the chips and built the devices and so forth, we have these devices, we have to find out how to use them, so we need to build a model of them that we can run simulation on. So those are the MOSFET models. And finally, what we'll see is these models that we described, they're what we wanted to make, but usually there's variation, especially because these processes are very complex, and therefore we have to know how we deal with this variation, and that's the part about process variation. So that's going to be the first part of our course for the first few lectures. Then we'll go into this second part, which I called Honey, I Shrunk the Transistors. And we'll start with some abstraction in VLSI design, because we're going to have lots and lots of transistors and lots of components. And I want to discuss how we actually take all these, this huge number of things and deal with them as engineers. It's a really not easy problem. Abstraction is the key to deal with that. Then we'll discuss design metrics, which is an important kind of intro concept of how we benchmark if what we're doing is good and how we compare between different things. And then the focal point of this part of shrinking the transistors is what we call process scaling. And process scaling, if you've heard about Moore's Law, which I'm sure you have, because Moore's Law is one of the main concepts in engineering or in computer engineering in general, has many flavors, but for sure for chip design, that's what Moore's Law comes from. And it's the basis of our field for the last 50 or 60 years. So that's process scaling, how we took these transistors, made them smaller and smaller, and how it affected us throughout the years. That led us to today's transistor, which is deeply nanoscaled. And there are many different effects that are not what our transistors used to look like and what we taught you in previous courses. So we'll discuss the nanoscale transistor, what happens with transistors in the last 10 years or so. And finally, we'll go into interconnect. Those are the wires that connect between the transistors how they affect us, because we used to not even pay attention to them, but now they're very important. So once we've had that and we know about the technology that's underlying that we're using to build these circuits, we can go out and play and build more complex circuits. So we'll start with sequential logic, which is how we build synchronous circuits, flip-flops and latches, and how we put them together and make systems. Then we can go into arithmetic circuits such as adders and multipliers, bigger, more complex circuits that can do more complex operations. Then we'll go into memory design. Memory is probably the most important part of any chip today, so we'll discuss how we build memories. And finally, we'll go into FinFETs and additional subjects that are very relevant nowadays and new and up and coming. But before we start at this, I want to discuss who I am and who we are. So I'm from Bar-Ilan University in Ramat Gan, Israel. What you see here in the picture is our beautiful engineering faculty. Our engineering faculty is the youngest faculty of engineering in Israel. It only was inaugurated as an engineering faculty in 2011, but we already are one of the top universities doing engineering work for sure in Israel and in Europe as well. And inside Bar-Ilan University, we have a team, we've compiled a team that we call EnICS, the Emerging Nanoscaled Integrated and Circuit System Labs. It's an impact center at Bar-Ilan University, which means that we're one of the focal points of the university in bringing forward a certain subject, and our subject is chip design or integrated circuit design. We're a team of five faculty members. So Professor Alex Fish, the guy over here, he started the labs in about 2014, 2015. And since then, the rest of us have joined. I'm Dr. Adam Teman, the guy over here. This is Professor Yossi Shor. He's a big analog expert. And here we have Dr. Osnat Karen, who's a coding expert. And she's our algorithmic lady on hardware security and coding. And Dr. Itamar Levy, who recently joined us, and he's another expert in hardware security and physical security. So the five of us, we work together. We have joint students. We have joint budgets, we have joint grants and joint infrastructure, and together we do state-of-the-art research and are the top VLSI research group in Israel. So here's a small picture of our team. We actually have probably at least twice this amount of people, but that's who we could get together that day and take a picture. And when we talk about EnICS, we see that we're the center of a different types of hubs that we can define. So the first and foremost thing is this innovation hub. That's where we're doing research. Okay, we're inventing new things, bringing new technology to the world. The second one, which we can't deny, of course, is the education hub, such as this course. These are courses that we're teaching the world. We're teaching our students and so forth about how to design chips and how to do research in chip design. Another very important thing is infrastructure. So what we're doing is we're building this infrastructure where different professors and actually different industrial members can use our infrastructure, our flows, our methodologies, and so forth, and including our servers and so forth. So we have this infrastructure hub. Okay. We have a training hub. So with our infrastructure, we also learn how to use new tools, learn how to develop flows, and we can go and teach the world how to do these things. And initiatives hub, where if we've developed a technology or someone's developed a technology, we can help bring them forward to commercialization, to be a startup, to productization, and so forth. And finally, we call it a networking hub. We host different events and bring together different academics and industrial members from Israel and the world to meet each other and to start talking to each other and networking with each other. So that's EnICS in a nutshell, and we'd like to hear from you. You can contact me or one of the other members of EnICS, and we'll be happy to discuss it with you, and maybe you can join. So now we'll move over to the world of chip design.